Reflected learning, this is a new element, in fact, of my job description as we try to get more and more faculty involved. So in some parts, I'm an evangelist. I'm the guy who's trying to convince you to do more of this stuff. But in other ways, I'm the support person for a lot of it. And this approach, this sort of curatorial approach that I'm going to talk about, is particularly notable, perhaps, because it seems to grab the attention and interest of humanities and social science faculty as a way into all the other stuff we talked about. So the approach itself is pretty simple. You start from the dichotomy that blended learning creates in how we use time. You have outside of class time using digital tools, you have in-class time with the face-to-face, highly interactive, high touch. And in our book, this is sort of a simplification of the way we're talking about these things today. But in our book, the digital time and spaces are all about enhancing the face-to-face spaces. And that's sort of how we sell it. On that premise, we add an existing priority for a lot of our faculty in humanities and social science, which is that their students should be making things. There's this idea amongst our faculty that there are certain challenges that their students might not get otherwise. It's the challenges of failure, right? Imagine or think about the comp sci student who has to deal with failure as part of their process. Troubleshooting. There's a real priority amongst our faculty of giving students in these disciplines a chance to experience these things in a productive way. And making is sort of the answer. And that making can be intense or it can be light, but the point is that it's being done critically, right? So it could be Pinterest or it could be Python, but the outcome goal is sort of the same, that they're doing this sort of skill-based work alongside this content. So you put all that together, and what we're talking about is having students use digital technology outside of class to build tools, and curate tools that they'll use in class for a deeper, different, and we hope fuller discussion. Again, this is by no means everything we're doing with blended learning, but it's had particular appeal with certain faculty. So how do we get to this tool-based approach? It's both a story of disruption and continuity, and how each has sort of been motivated. The disruption is probably quite familiar to you all, MOOCs and all that. This sort of, you know, we're looking at the same trend lines and headlines and thinking, you know, what do we need to do to protect ourselves against this? What do we need to get out ahead of this stuff and make sure we can still be who we are and still do what we're best at doing? You know, we've been exploring the idea of online courses, fully online courses. And we actually have a pilot this summer in data visualization. It's a collaboration between CompSci and media studies. And we'll see how that goes. But generally, there's been a lot of resistance to the faculty to this idea. The argument against it is that students come to Wheaton for a high-touch residential experience, where that's the real value of what they're getting. And that's, so far, at least very difficult to replicate online. The relationship with faculty and classmates that they get in class and the network that this creates for them is really a core of our institutional identity. And so with the option of blended learning, we can sort of shift the question, right? It can be less about how can we use technology to keep up and more about how can we use technology to make us more like ourselves? How can we use technology to protect what matters most to us? And I think for us, it's that face-to-face time and that interaction. It helps a lot that we have communities of practice that already exist on campus that are asking these questions about teaching and technology, and we've had to draw on them and their energy to sort of build this out with blended learning. For small liberal arts college, we do have just a large number of digital humanists who are really bringing it into their classrooms. Right? We have an NEH grant for a course called Computing for Poets. They're doing real text mining with Python, and these are mostly English communities doing that. We also are institutional partners in the Tapas project, which is about building a repository for TI documents. So we have digital humans doing this sort of active technical learning with students who may start from a place of resistance to those things. And their work is very much focused on that kind of project. We also have a lot of folks doing visual storytelling work, multimedia production, having students make podcasts and videos and so on. A great example of that is our Watson Conversation series. It's all done through a couple of our history classes where students are making podcasts in response to a work of art. And then that podcast is going on to a growing collection of these along with the images for the artwork that they're responding to. And this is something that just lives on our history site and is there for people to find. We have a growing number of people interested in mobile learning, iPads. We have a number of iPads that we've lent out for field work, but also this multimedia production stuff. And we do have a maker space, which is located in CompSci, but embodies this idea of reaching out to students who aren't technically inclined, getting them to make stuff. So it's focused on 3D printing. We've expanded it to include a fiber space within wearable clothing and wearable computing and that kind of stuff. And the red thread in all of this is something like information fluency, something like, in addition to these content outcomes, what skills-based outcomes can students be getting from the way that an assignment or course is done? So if a student can learn audio production in addition to learning all the content they learn from examining and analyzing a work of art, that's great. That fits with our goals as an institution. We've also had to think about, well, what are our existing structures of support and how can we use these to support blended learning? We are a merged library and technology group. My team that I serve on is the research and instruction team. There's half technologists and half librarians. So we have librarians who are doing a lot of teaching and have a very particular and, I think, useful perspective on teaching with technology. Having been in that position, I can say it's very eye-opening the range of technical skills students actually have and the things that they'll have trouble with despite being completely facile. And they're not afraid to let us know that they're having trouble in the same way, maybe, because we're not grading them for whatever reason. And so we have a real useful perspective on that. We also have our own curriculum. We go into every first year seminar and we have what we think of as a skunk works. You know, we think of it as a space to try things out. We started trying out blended learning stuff in the FYS context so that, you know, we're working with FYS with a large number of faculty across all disciplines. So we're sort of, in a way, disseminating these ideas through that context. But then we also have our liaisons going on to other courses throughout the curriculum. And we have the space to say, okay, let's try something new this time. Right? There's a lot of openness to that. And then we also have these internal grants for teaching with technology. They're focused on innovation. I think we fund about 6 to 10 of them a semester. We fund as many as we have money for. Those tend to be equipment focused. Sometimes they're about buying student worker time, but they all culminate in this internal dissemination and the brown bag, right? And so it creates this culture of teaching with technology as neat stuff, right? As a place to try new things. And there's a lot of energy around that experimentation. So in this context, where our conversations about technology often come back, pedagogy, we've been thinking of blended learning as a pedagogical solution that has other benefits, right? I think earlier was mentioned that a lot of the interest in blended learning and online learning starts from an efficiency standpoint. And we're sort of thinking, well, it might eventually have that, but it has to be a pedagogical solution for it first. We're asking certain questions like, what can we push outside of class time so that we can have more class time for the things that can only happen there, that really high value stuff? And then more complicated questions that fit blended learning into these existing communities of practice and their values and priorities. So how can blended learning be active learning, right? How can blended learning be project-based learning? And then, you know, maybe in the biggest question, at least for this presentation, is what does a blended assignment look like in the context of what we're already doing? So by way of example, just this semester, I was approached by an English professor teaching the methods course, and she wanted to transform an assignment she'd been teaching for years in which students use MLA International Bibliography to assemble a critical reception history of Wuthering Heights. And the goal of this assignment is to see how temporal and constructed literary criticism itself is, because the reception of Wuthering Heights in 1880 is very different from the reception even in 1930, let alone today. And so they get that, that important information literacy training and learning how to use MLA and National Bibliography and other related resources that work for this assignment. But they were, in the original iteration, just writing a paper for this. And she came to me and she said, I would like to make this more of a way of introducing them to digital humanities concepts. And also, I would like to make this more blended. So I'm newly in this position that's about blended learning, and I see this opportunity I have to build something that can serve as an example for other faculty. And so what we decided to do is, instead of having them write a paper, we have them as a group contribute to a timeline of the reception over time. So we divided them into groups, assigned them to individual decades between the publication date and the present, and had them train them on MLA, and had them go out and find all the citations they could within their decade, right? Then they came back, we talked about digital humanities methodologies, the idea of distant reading versus close reading, right? What you can get out of distant reading as opposed to the close reading that they've mostly been trained to do up to this point in their major. And we trained them how to contribute to a digital timeline. And the timeline itself was actually based in JSON. It's a tool called Timeline.js, and I can recommend it generally. One of the nice things about it is that the students don't have to learn JSON, so they don't have to do any coding to contribute to this neat looking timeline, but all they have to do is field out their data into a Google spreadsheet. It hooks up to Google Drive. And as an organization that uses Google Apps, that's even simpler for us because the students already are just using the login they already have, right, to get in. And I built a website that supported this process for them, gave them resources for the research. We talked a lot about the research component as really being about metadata, right? So why is this article showing up in the search? Well, the answer is in the record, right? If you look in a database record, you have everything you need to know, literally everything the database knows about that article or book is in that record, sort of getting them to think in that systems way. And then they came back in the class, they populated the timeline very smoothly. That's where we were expecting the most trouble, the students sort of writing late on a Sunday night saying, I can't get my citation to display. There's no such issue, but great. And then what we got in class was this sort of class presentation that involved everybody, right? So everybody was both a contributor and an audience for the discussion we had using this timeline. They each had their sort of area of expertise, and then we had them choose their three most representative citations from their decade as a small group. So they made some sort of curatorial choices about what went on there and why. And then to the group, they said why. So here's what we chose and why. Here are the trends we saw and so on. And we did a little bit of other data visualizations with the subject headings we found in the databases. So what are the subject headings for Wuthering Heights in the 60s versus the present? And that is for the website itself. Maybe if we have time in the Q&A, I can show you the time. So they're getting two kinds of outcomes, right? Learning outcomes. They're getting the ones, they're asking the questions in discussion and in the processes. Well, they're going to making the tools and curating them. So why these things and not others, right? Why these three citations when we have 20 others to choose from? What makes these representative? Why these three together? Are you covering some sort of breadth by choosing these particular three? And they're getting to these sort of information fluency outcomes. They're thinking about field of data with the spreadsheet. They're thinking about how systems are built and so on. And it became a very gentle way to introduce them to digital humanities without taking on actual programs, which, as we know, we can take a full course for. But then they also have the chance to use the tools. So when it's their turn in the discussion, where they're not the group that's explaining the choices, they ask these questions like, how do we see these things? What questions arise from this? The sort of typical questions we might think of as the content question. It's more about critical thinking. And that goes towards the content. So I mentioned that this approach has been a popular a way of getting in with humanists and social scientists. And just as an example of that, just this month, we awarded 8 grants for course transformation funding to disseminate the whole faculty. 7 of those 8 are humanists or social scientists. And 6 of those 7, I believe, include assignments like this. Now, that's not mutually exclusive to all the other stuff we're talking about today. They're using quizzes and using the tools and whatnot. They're doing things like online office hours and so on. But they're using this logic of making tools and using tools, right? Information fluency and content fluency. So just some of the ones that we have in the works, we have stuff with map annotation. We have our history professor who is really focused on museum studies, and she's building a whole assignment out of the idea of provenance and tracking items from where they started and where they ended up and whether or not that jives with the ESCO and whatnot, and that being the basis for presentations and discussion. We have folks doing multimedia production and going back to sort of those communities of practice with the women's studies class that is the capstone. And they're going to go to different nonprofits in the Providence and southeastern Massachusetts area and gather media from these folks, interviews, so on, and build a map, like a resource map of nonprofits focused on women's issues that has the potential to just be a resource for people in the area. Becomes sort of a service learning kind of thing as well. So that's what we have in the works. I would love to show you guys the timeline if we have time, but I want to give Professor Torres a chance to do her part of the presentation. So maybe during the Q&A we can come back with it.
I would like to see the timeline.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Now, do we have internet connection on this computer?
Yes, we do. Oh, on mine, no.
Okay, so we got to switch.
What's that?
Yeah, well. So there are a lot of things I think we'll do differently in the second iteration. And frankly, I think we came up against, one of the perennial problems of blended learning when we spent the year earlier. And that we had more to do than we had planned for, right? And so this came to me midterm. And so we were sort of thinking of it as a pilot. So maybe we can talk about some different things.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, the caps. This is the benefit of having a slide.
No, it's 1474.
Sorry. 1474. I guess an error is better than coming up with someone else's vision. There we go. Okay, so we used Google Sites, and that was the evangelist in me made that decision just because we were new to Google Apps, and I wanted faculty to know that this was a relatively easy thing to do. And it's really easy to embed things in a Google site. And so, whereas we are mostly a WordPress shop, this seemed like the kind of thing, especially if we want to encourage independence, that could maybe happen in Google Sites. It's something the faculty can set up without working through us. So as you can see, there's a lot of support material on here. There's the learning outcomes. There is a bit about finding resources, and I inherited a rather exhaustive handout from my predecessor for this assignment, for the old version of this assignment, so we included that here. I built with this tool, and then my favorite tool for screen captures is called, I'm blanking on it, sketch. If you are looking to capture things like this off the internet, or really anything off your desktop, you want to be able to annotate it quickly and easily, that's the way to do it. But these are full instructions for adding to the timeline. So like I said, they're just working with certain fields and just making clear which ones they're working with. This is my example. Coco, Peter, an astoundingly dated consideration of weather and heights. Journal of astoundingly dated considerations. This is an abstract. I changed that to something about putting a man on the moon. So they have their full instructions on here. That's maybe the most blended element of this in some ways in a traditional sense. Then we have a little bit about Zotero, which I think we'll cut next time. I think we had enough to talk about without naming Zotero installs in class. And then we have the timeline itself. So this is timeline.js, which is freely available. Anybody can use it. It's just embedded. And so what we did in class is we just went through these. And okay, why did this group choose this one? And they gave a little bit of an abstract, a little bit of a discussion of how it fit contextually with what came before it and afterwards. So you have different views here. You can scroll out and get a sense of the hits across deadlines, decades. There's a lot of potential, I think, in the next iteration for this to get into a more regimented use of subject headings and other metadata, right? So, MLA and maybe some of the resources we use for the earlier stuff, because MLA is not going to have stuff from 1870, can be a little inconsistent in what kind of information it provides, right, about an article. But thinking about other things we could put in here besides just a citation and maybe a brief summary or something. So this is really easy. I mean, this took me probably took me several hours to figure out that this was the right tool to use, timeline.js. I had to test a number of timelining platforms. This was the only one that really allowed crowdsourced entry, right? Which was important to us. And I wanted to do something that would embed easily, that they didn't have to have another login for and all that. But once we figured that out, the work of building the site, the Google site, probably 2 hours. That's something that I'll use.
Could you add an image as one of the
things?
Yep. Link to an image that would then be posted somewhere.
Yep. It's a little more complicated, but yes. Mm-hmm. And I think I think there's a certain, one of the bugs we encountered is a certain number of citations that actually are not displaying. For whatever reason, timeline.js had trouble once we got past 40 or 50. Mm-hmm. So things like that to work out. But as a proof of concept, it worked quite nicely. And the students, everybody was prepared for that conversation. Right? And sometimes I think that's really one red thread in blended learning is accountability, right? Mm-hmm. And they were all prepared and they all were experts on their piece of it, which seemed crucial. Yeah.
What was the advantage of using sites.google rather than just a Wheaton site?
Well, this actually is both in a sense, because this is through our Google Apps buy. And so the advantage was that I wanted to show this off as something that people could use. A Wheaton site would have been a WordPress, which is a different platform. Maybe no less suited in terms of display and so on, but just sort of from an institutional perspective, I wanted to show off this possibility because I think it's easier for faculty to use it without mediation. And students, by the way, can have access to this stuff too. So if Gabriella's students had decided not to use Facebook, they would have at least had the option to use Google Sites.
This, in terms of, I don't know, it's a horrible way to think, but protection of the work that's been done here, is it enrolled so that only certain people can change?
You have that option, yes. So I believe I have this set up so that anybody who has the link can get to and see this site. But editing is limited to either you have different options. You can, and this is a nice thing about Google Sites, is that this sort of permissions stuff is really easy. You can say people with a link, you can say people I invite individually. You know, I tend to use people with a link because that's less work and solves the same problem and allows me to show it at a conference without too much inconvenience. But you do have a lot of options there. So, and by the way, anybody can use Google Sites. It's just that you would log in with a Gmail account rather than your account, depending on whether or not you can use Google Apps as this.
So this was an assignment so that the students had to do this. So I guess, Gabriella, I'm curious, you had a class of 35, right?
Yeah.
And how did you get buy-in from all 35 that this is the project they wanted to do? And what about students who were kind of, I mean, presumably some students were more excited about this than others.
So because the project had multiple parts, so one part was a video, to get people to think about issues. The other part was the secrets. The other part was going around campus talking to people about violence against women. Mm-hmm. So we had mobile teams where people just went and stopped people and said, "Have you seen this? What do you think of it?" And you know, actually, some people were very excited about the Facebook campaign at the beginning and very critical of it at the end,
uh-huh.
Right? When it had spread. So and then they were talking to people about it and trying to get reception of what we did. So there were enough pieces that people were interested in doing that we actually didn't have a problem of buying.
Okay.
So we had one group of students that said, "We don't have, in our research, we've learned that the issue of violence against women targeted at women of color in the United States is a different issue, and it's an issue that has much higher rates. So we'd like to, as part of this, have a specific conversation with women of color." So they had an event just for women of color that was restricted. And they didn't want to work on some of the other parts. And so people found ways to enter the project in different ways and then reintegrate it to our online space. Mm-hmm. So part of the women of color discussion was the creation of art, which then we posted as ways for people to talk about.
And how much time did you spend on that kind of we call it community building or deciding what you were going to
half
do?
Half a course.
Okay.
Yeah. So we spent several weeks. It's a long investment.
I think that's a really important point. I mean, this was I think it was three total class periods and then all the work in between. And I think next time it should easily be twice that. I mean, these sort of things do take up a lot of space. And in a methods course, you know, where this is just the digital humanities piece, right? It's also a reflection on how criticism changes over time, so it's useful in that way. How much time can you give to that? I understand that issue.
Okay, well, in the interest of keeping us somewhat on schedule, so this clock says 3:50, that clock says 3:55. Upstairs, it's going to be about 10 minutes later, earlier. So we could either agree to come back down here in about 10 minutes, or we could just stay. I don't know if you guys feel the need for a break, need to get up, move around, or just want to start the next sessions. Stay? I see. Okay. Feedback. Hands if you want. Okay. Great. Great. Okay.
Yeah.